All right, let's do our offering. You got it. Lord, I choose to obey your word, for as I dwell and walk in your presence, I shall not lack. Poverty be far from me and my household, in Jesus' name. I will walk in your blessings, Lord. I will rise above all that hell has to offer and accept heaven's best here on earth. Everything I set my hands to will prosper because I make you my dwelling place. You are my refuge and my fortress. Thank you, Lord, for your provision. I accept it by faith, fully expecting your blessings in every area of my life. For wherever your presence is, there is no lack. Therefore, Lord, as we receive today's offering, we are believing you for abundant harvest, health, jobs and better jobs, raises and bonuses, benefits, sales and commissions, favorable settlements, estates and inheritance, interest and income, rebates and returns, checks in the mail, gifts and surprises, scholarships and grants, inventions with royalties, finding money, bills paid off, bills decreased, blessings and increase, bargains and child support. Thank you, Lord, for meeting all of our financial needs, that we may have more than enough to give into the kingdom of God and promote the gospel of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah and amen. So, again, where was it? Media, you know, what channel can you turn to and expect to hear the truth about absolutely anything? They're not accountable. And now all of a sudden, the social media pages, Facebook, Twitter, all those, they're not accountable anyway. And they won't allow anything on there that's the truth. All right. In fact, they're editing just about everything that comes on there because they're bought off. Everybody's bought off. We have all these millionaires and billionaires who are trying to control and manipulate this whole country and produce a new world order. They've been working on it for years, and they just get stronger and stronger, more bold, and they've become unaccountable. And the best that we can do, of course, is pray. That's always the answer, is that we pray and trust God and know that if there's going to be a turnaround, it will be because God begins to hold people, places, things accountable. Amen. And so those things are other than us praying about it, recognizing it and praying about it. And just let me share this with you. You need to be in relationship with God so that you can sort out everything that you hear in this country. You need to be in relationship because you're going to hear a lot of things that are going to make you wonder, is that really true? Can I believe that? It does all of us. And the only way that we're really going to know the truth is if Holy Spirit lives inside of us, because he knows the truth. He is the truth. And then he can tell us when not to hear and what to hear. And again, we've got to do our part. And the biggest part that we play, of course, is praying. So we always know that. So there is a lack of accountability. And the more that I thought about that, I have realized that in the 28 years that we have been here at Word of Faith Family, the reason why that our seats are not full is because people do not want to be accountable. Probably the number one reason today in our world, that in the United States, that's our world right here, that people are not saved and don't serve God is because they do not want to be accountable to God, to His Son, or to the church. They don't want to be accountable. They don't want to be told what they can do, what they can't do. They don't want anybody to argue with them about their belief system. They don't want to be held accountable. And it comes down to the fact that people love easy. Amen. You know, there was a commercial on TV where they had a button and it said easy, and you push the easy button. Well, all of us would kind of like that in certain areas of our life, but know this, nowhere in the 66 books that make up God's word does it say that it's going to be easy. Easy to live, easy to serve, easy to win souls. The only thing that's easy is for a person to get born again. It's easy to be saved. Amen. You can do what the brothers, sisters did today. Just kneel down at an altar, spend about 5 minutes in prayer with God, ask forgiveness, accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior. You can be saved. It's easy. Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. But in our society, in our world, with the strength that the devil has gained over society over the past 6,000 years, maintaining our Christian life, Christian walk, and being accountable to God has gotten more difficult than what it's ever been. I promise you that it's harder now to live for God for most people than it was 20 years ago, 30 years ago, 40 years ago, 50 years ago, because the propaganda and lies of the devil have just gone forth. It's been appropriated by TV and radio and men and women who didn't know the truth. They preached lies from pulpits. And there is so much religion in the world. And eventually, of course, if you know anything about the last days and the end time, eventually there will be a one world church. And it will not be Christianity. It will be a false religion that come out of the very pits of hell. And so you're going to need to know the truth. That's all that there is to it. When it gets hard, know this, when it gets hard and people hear what they don't want to hear, people want to run. How many of us in this room have had ideas of running before? Come on, be honest. Ideas of running. Well, it's just too hard. I just don't think I agree with that. I just don't like the way the preacher said that. I just don't like what's going on down there at that church. I just listen to those words. I just don't. Amen. Well, we should have just went ahead and said, I just don't want to be held accountable, because that's what you were actually feeling and you were saying it in your heart, whether you ever said it with your mouth or not. I'm pastor and I felt like running a few times. Amen. And even pastors are held accountable. We talked about that in the previous sermon. Everybody's accountable to somebody. And before it's over with, everybody who won't be held in account of their life on earth will be held accountable when they stand before God. Those will not be pleasant days for many people in this society and in our world. And it will be because they did not listen to the message, because the gospel is being preached. The availability of the gospel of Jesus Christ is everywhere like it's never been. TBN, other Christian broadcasts, they're all over the world. They're preaching the gospel everywhere by airways through the media. You know, that is the good stuff that you can listen to and hear. And so the opportunity for people to be saved is everywhere. And there's Bibles everywhere. There's preachers everywhere. There's Christians everywhere. People just don't want to be accountable. Now, in John chapter 6, and I'm not going to read you a lot of scripture. Your homework assignment will be to read all of chapter 6. And it's kind of interesting, and I wanted to go there because what we have there is we have Jesus Christ feeding everybody. Amen. Most of you remember that miracle. They gathered on the mountain. He preached to thousands. They didn't have no food. They said, what are we going to do about food? This little boy's got four loaves and three fishes or something down that line. Amen. And so Jesus took the bread, did he not? And he blessed it. He broke it. The disciples passed it out. They fed thousands that day. Not just hundreds, not just, but thousands, possibly somewhere in the neighborhood of 10 to 20,000 people were fed that day. And now notice, Jesus was very popular with people at this time. Very popular. He got really popular when they all began to eat. And the Bible says their bellies was full and they're up on the mountain. The day is beautiful. Jesus has been teaching, but he hadn't taught anything that's very controversial as yet. He's just been teaching good stuff and they've been getting it. And he teaches in parables and they understand it. And everybody's kind of excited about being with Jesus. And then they get fed and everybody's, you know how you make men happy, right? You got to a man's heart through his tummy. Jesus got through a whole lot of people's hearts that day through their tummy, but it didn't change their hearts. It just made them feel good about themselves. And after that was over, he left. You read it this afternoon. This is when he left. He got on a boat, sent the disciples out, and then he walked on the sea. Most of you know that story. He's trying to get away from that multitude because everybody's loving on him right then. Everybody's loving Jesus. Everything is good. There's not been anything. Nobody's apple cart's been upset. He didn't knock nobody's chip off their shoulder up there on the mountain. He just made them all feel good. In fact, they're feeling so good right then. They're like, hey, you know what? We need to make him king. We need to set him on a throne. We liking this really good. And he's able to supply our physical needs. Amen. Oh, they was loving it. And he thought, I got to get out of here. So he did. He sent the disciples out on the boat. Later in the night, storm comes up. They're all scared to death. You know that story. Jesus comes walking to them across the water. And they get in fear. They have that same human thing that we've got. They got in fear when it got scary a little bit. Jesus said, don't be afraid. I won't preach about Peter walking on the water, but when Jesus said, come on then, if you believe it's me, come on. All things are possible to him that believe. Peter did walk on the water. Don't ever let anybody fool you and say that nobody but Jesus ever walked on the water, because Peter walked on it. I don't know how many steps he actually took, but he took a couple. If he only took two, he still walked on the water. Then he got his eyes off of Jesus and he began to sink. You guys know that message, don't you? You get your eyes off Jesus and you will immediately begin to sink. All right? It may take you a while, but you're eventually going to sink. And if you can't swim on your own, you eventually is going to drown. Amen? If you don't call on Jesus. So make sure that you spend a lot of time calling on Jesus, because most days we spend a little time sinking. We do. Most time we get our eyes off the Lord. Something happens at work. Somebody says something. We got up and had a flat tire on the car, whatever it may be. You know, these little things, it doesn't take a lot sometimes for us to get our eyes off of the Lord. And so when you do, just remember what Jesus said. All right, get your eyes back on me. He's always got his hand stretched out. Know that his hand is always stretched out to rescue you. No matter where you are, what you're going through, his arms is always stretched out. And if he needs to take you by the hand, pick you up and hug you, or carry you back to the boat, let me tell you, Jesus is there for you. Know that. Amen? All right, now that's not the message. Everybody's loving on him. So they get to the other side, and many of them find out where he's at. So here they come. They're liking this man who can turn five loaves and four loaves, three fishes, whatever it was, into a regular meal. Now when he gets over there, the crowd's thinned down. He doesn't have near as many people. This time he begins to preach a little different message. This time he begins to preach about, I am the bread of life. Amen. And unless you eat this bread, it's found in John chapter number 6, verse number 54. Jesus said this. He said, you must eat my flesh and drink my blood. Amen. Whosoever eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. And you know what? So many people in that crowd did. They went like, whoa, wait a minute. What did he just say? Yeah, all of a sudden, everything begins to change. One day, they want to make him king, and now all of a sudden, they don't like what they're hearing. In case you haven't figured it out yet, you're not always going to hear what you want to hear. Amen. You're not always going to hear it from me or from any other preacher. I love you. God loves you. Hopefully, you love me, and you'll know that God's Word, sometimes the Word can be real serious and can touch us in a very serious way sometimes. And it will eventually, at some point in time, the Word will prick your heart. At some point in time, you're going to hear something that you don't understand, you don't really believe, and you don't even really want to believe that. You're going to hear something from the world, from the pulpit, from pastors. You may even hear it from the Holy Spirit, because Holy Spirit lives inside of you to convict you of sin. And so you're going to hear some things that will make you say, whoa. All right? Just like they did that day. They begin to question, how in the world can this happen? We don't understand this. We don't get this. Who are you to say this? They begin to question his authority then. They begin to question his reality and the words that he had to say, because if you're going to believe part of what the message is, you need to believe all the message. You hear me? If you're going to believe part of this Bible, we've got to believe all of this Bible. Amen? Because this is all the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth, so help me God. Amen? That's what this word is. No, we won't understand it all. And no, we won't be able to explain it all. And maybe we won't even be able, you might not understood this at that time. Before I was saved, I'd be thinking like, okay, what? I'm going to eat his flesh and drink his blood? Before I got saved? Before I was taught on communion? Before I understood that he gave his life for me? He died on a cross? All right, shed his blood seven ways so that I can eat his flesh and drink his blood. Amen. That would have been a hard saying. In fact, that's what verse number 60 says there. They're like, whoa, this is a hard saying. Already they were like, this is too tough for me. Amen. I've had people tell me that in the church. This is too hard. this is too hard. I don't want to hear that. This makes me feel bad. I had a girl one time tell me, I cry every time I come to church. That's not a bad thing. Ruby does it too. Amen. Brother Dale does it most every Sunday. And if I'm crying for, it doesn't matter why I'm crying. If the word makes me cry because it convicts me, good. If it chastises me and I cry, good. If I'm rejoicing and I cry, good. If I'm loving on you and I cry, good. Amen. Crying is a good thing. She didn't realize that was a good thing because she was not used to crying. And yeah, I've probably said some things that people didn't know how to take. And some, I may say some today that you don't know how to take. It may be a hard saying, but just because it's a hard saying, if it's the word of God, then just go with it. Amen. Just take it, meditate on it, think on it, study on it, understand it before you reject it. Amen. Learn to understand what was being said before you just throw it out. All right. And say, oh, no, I don't want no part of that. Because we've got to learn how to live by the truth. Because the truth will hold us accountable. We're going to get to that in a little bit. In verse 66, and when Davis was taking these notes, he said, wow, John 6, 6. Everybody should be able to remember this one. One of the first ones that I ever learned. John 6, 6. 6, 6, 6. Anybody got that? Do I need to teach on the mark of the beast, Revelation chapter 13, sometime, that, and it's coming. It's coming to a household near you. Just know that. Well, in John 6, 6, it said, from that time, many of his disciples went back and walked no more with him. All right? It was too hard for them. One day, they're loving them. One day, they're loving the miracle of being fed. And then the next day, it's too hard. You know how many times I have seen this in the church? I have seen people get right with God, serve God a week, 2 weeks, 2 months, 3 months, how many four boys have come in and went back out because it was too hard? They thought it was too hard. They give up. They quit before they ever gave God a chance. They wouldn't allow the word to work. Many of them thought it just wouldn't work, won't work for me. From that time, many of his disciples went back. Now, we don't know the number, but we know up on that mountain there was 5,000 men plus women and children. How many of them made the trip? We don't know. How many of them left that day? We don't know, but many of them left because it was too hard. And they could not grasp the concept of the message that Jesus shared with them that day. And if you read through there, he explains it very well. It's not like he left them wondering what he really meant. They could not accept that he was the Messiah, the Son of the living God, that he would die for them, that he would rise again for them. They could not agree with that, accept that, and they did it and they left. They did not want to be accountable to what Jesus was saying. That's what's happened in the church in my day in the last number of years. People do not want to be accountable to the word of God that they hear. And they'll blame it on the preacher. They'll blame it on the denomination of the church that they're going to. They got all kinds of, they'll pass the buck, so to speak, and blame others because personally they do not want to be accountable for themselves. If there's one thing that all of us must gather from this month of accountability is that you're going to answer and you need to start answering now. Amen. And you need to know why you answer and who you answer to and why that you do it, what's important about it. Because of this reason right here, to serve Christ, you must be accountable to him. You cannot serve him and be found faithful as a servant unless you are being held accountable by him. Amen. Because he's the one that corrects of sin. He's the one that points it out. Ultimately, it falls on him. Amen. Now, here's where the message needs to go. If I'm going to serve Christ and be accountable to him, there's four areas that we got to look at first. The first one is, I got to be accountable to the word of God. I'm never going to know what God thinks or how he feels unless I study the word and I read it for myself. Sure, we tell you that week after week after week, and I guess I don't know, we're trying to beat it in your head or we just know how real that it is. You've got to know the truth. You're accountable for what the word tells you. A lot of people don't want to be accountable. That's why they won't open their Bibles. That's why they leave it on a church pew from 1 week to the next, because they're not going to open it up anyway. They carry it home, put it on a shelf, and so they know right where it's at next time they go to church. Listen, you've got to start studying for yourself. You're accountable for the word. When you know, simply put, this is our rule book. This tells you what you can and cannot do. This tells you what pleases God and does not please God. This tells you what is right in our world and what's wrong in our world. This will tell you we're in the category of good and the categories of evil. And without you reading this, you'll begin to take the word of people that you should not take their word for it. You should not take a singly and solely the word of your pastor and base all your theology on what I teach you. You should study for yourself. Prove me whether I'm right or wrong. Holy Spirit will take you places I can't take you. Amen. Yeah, he knows deeper things than what I know. He knows what touches you personally. He knows what affects you, what needs to be challenged, what you need to be challenged with on a weekly basis. God knows that. All you got to do is get into the Word. Study it. Meditate on it. Think on it. Wear it out. Amen. Wear it out. Wear your Bible out with usage. Learn the rules. Amen. When we get a new piece of equipment at work, you know what they do? They come with manuals. In fact, the last new truck that I got that I drove, spreader truck, it came with a bag that weighed about 20 pounds. It had five different books in it. You know what they told me I needed to do? I needed to go through every book. Look at them, read them, learn what's in there, know how to operate that equipment. I said, this is the fifth truck. I think I know by now. You know what I did with that? I did what most of us do with our Bible. I put it in the office under the scale head so they'd have it if they needed it, right? Well, we got our Bibles. We have it if we need it. Well, what you need to do is learn it. Amen? Learn it. Don't take my word for anything. If you ask me, I'll tell you what I think, and I'll tell you what I've come to know, and if I'm not absolutely sure about it, I'll tell you I'm not absolutely sure about it. If you ask me a question and I think, well, I don't really know, here's how I feel about it, then don't you take that as honest God gospel truth. But when I stand in this pulpit and I tell you something, it'll be because God told me to say it. Amen? So know this, you're accountable to what? First, to His Word. And then you're accountable to the Holy Spirit. In Ephesians chapter 4, verse 30, Paul told the church there, he said, do not grieve the Holy Spirit. He came to live in your heart when you got born again. If you're saved today, Holy Spirit lives inside of you, and you're not supposed to make Him sick. You're not supposed to turn Him off and say, I'm not listening to you today. You're not supposed to ignore the Holy Spirit. Benny Hinn wrote a book, Good Morning, Holy Spirit. It was an awesome book because we need to be aware that God has blessed us with one of the greatest things that we could ever obtain on earth. That is the presence of the Holy Spirit to live inside of us. And what do? We try to do Holy Spirit job instead of letting Holy Spirit do His job. Amen. I am accountable to the Holy Spirit. He's in here trying to get me straight. He's in here trying to teach me, comfort me, preserve me, all right, love me, show me the love of God, educate me. Holy Spirit is. So I'm accountable to the Holy Spirit. You know what? We're going to stand before God one day. Do we want Him to say, remember how you treated my spirit? No. We don't want, no, we do not want to hear Him say that. We want Him to say, thank you for being good to my spirit. Amen. Thank you for loving on Him. Thank you for listening to Him. Thank you for allowing Him to be a part of your everyday life. Did you catch that? Everyday life. Not only we're accountable to the Word and His Spirit, but we're also accountable to His under-shepherds. Remember that authority that I shared with you, apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers? Who am I but an under-shepherd? I work for Jesus. Amen. I work for Him. To be a shepherd over you, because you are part of His flock that He has placed under my care. Whether you like it or not, I am responsible for you. That's why that I can't stand up here and tickle your ears every Sunday. It's why that I can't just make you happy, happy, happy all the time. It's why that I got to tell you that there are certain things that you can't do, certain things you shouldn't do, certain things you better do. It's why we got to point out Scripture, preach the truth. All right, because every one of us, including the under shepherd, needs to change. And I will give an account of what I have said to each one of you, how I have treated you. Sometimes I have to repent because I make fun of Steve and I shouldn't do that. All right, and sometimes Steve has to repent because of how he treats the boys. Amen. I know. So I have to repent. I say, God, forgive me. I should be better. I don't need to call Harry because it's not his name. Amen. And I don't need to call my buddy Scott Chicken. He's not here today because it's once or twice ain't bad. But, you know, you can run anything in the ground. So, yeah, we all make mistakes. I make mistakes. Know that. I still love you. And if you accept me as your pastor, then you have accepted the fact that you become accountable to me. So if I tell you something you don't like, don't get mad at me. If I preach something you don't like, don't get mad at me. If I don't treat you on a particular Sunday the way you felt like I should treat you, don't get mad at me. Amen. I try not to ignore anybody. I try to make sure I shake hands with everybody and make sure I tell you that I love you. If I get an opportunity, I'll hug your neck. I'll kiss you. I'll kiss you guys if you need me to, make you feel better. It's all right. I love you. I'm here and I'm responsible for you. And so I got to make sure that there are no barriers between me and you. Amen. And then because I'm the under-shepherd and your shepherd, I'm here to help you any way that I can. So we offer our help. If you need us, you let us know. And thank God Susan is the greatest wife and under-shepherd with me that she could possibly be. And she ministers. I must have got 40 texts the other day because they were praying and believing and standing together. And I was busy. I didn't even have time to look at all of them at the same time. So thank God I've got a good helper. And you know what? You're accountable to her too because she's with me. We twain become one flesh. Because we're the under-shepherds here. And then, of course, don't forget this. You're accountable to Jesus Christ himself. Amen. We pray to God through Jesus. When we're talking to God, we're talking through the mouth of Jesus Christ. And what we may speak our words, but they come out of his mouth. We are accountable to him. He's the one that died for us. He's the one that suffered such pain and agony. He's the one that rose the third day with the keys to death, hell, and the grave. He's the one who stands at the right hand of the Father at this very moment, interceding for each one of us. He is our advocate. We have a friend in Jesus, amen. A friend who sticketh closer than a brother. A friend who loves at all time. A friend whose love covers a multitude of our sins. We have the greatest thing that there is, yes. And I know that it's hard sometimes for us to be accountable to each other. But listen, we've got to find it in us to be accountable to him every day of our life. And when I become accountable to him, all right, I can become more accountable to those that are under me. But a lot of times we have to become accountable to the Word and to his Spirit and to his under shepherds before our relationship with him grows to that place where we are accountable to him. Amen. So they all four count. And let's talk about Jesus for a minute. Can we do that? Why Jesus anyway? Why? Of everything, amen, why Jesus? Well, the truth is, there's four areas why Jesus. And sometimes I don't talk about him probably enough, but today I am because I want to be accountable to him, amen. You know what? I don't have to convince you that Jesus was real, do I? But we live in a society, in a world today, where millions and millions of people don't really believe in Jesus Christ. They don't really believe that he was real. There are other religions that acknowledge him as a man of God, a great prophet, but he was not Jesus and was not the Messiah. And we have the Jews, the most beloved people of God that there are, and many of them don't even believe that Jesus, all right, is the Messiah or was the Messiah. They don't believe that. And yet anybody who's had any sense in our world has accepted the fact that Jesus was the Son of God. If you want to do some research and look at the greatest minds throughout time, they will tell you that Jesus was the living Son of God who died and rose again. Amen. And you know what? Many people, we see things and we take it for granted, and we read things and we take them for granted. Do you ever stop and think about the fact that his birth alone is recognized every single day by every nation in the world? Because our time is divided by after death, before Christ and after death. Every time that you write on a check, the year 2020, you have acknowledged his birth. Every time you look at a calendar, you have acknowledged his birth. Every country in the world acknowledges his birth. Yeah, Jesus was real. He was real. He is real. And he will always be real because he was the same yesterday, today, and forever. He died. He rose again to ever live so that someday we might go be with him. Every historical, you can go through history and read all the accounts, and you'll find out that the best account is in here. I'm telling you, he was seen by 500 at one time. They ate with him. They talked with him. Thomas stuck his hand in his side where he was pierced. It's been proven. No, I don't have to convince you, but we live in a world where that our testimony has got to be such that we can prove to our world that they need to be accountable to Jesus Christ. So why do I need to be accountable? Because he's real. It's fact. Then there's all this scriptural evidence. Amen? All the scripture. It's amazing. You know what? This whole Bible is about Jesus Christ. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So from the very creation of the earth until the very last page, Revelation chapter 21, the whole book is about Jesus. You can find him in every book, all 66. There has never been anything more prophecy that's been fulfilled than the prophecy of Jesus Christ himself. From 600 years and way back before his birth, right on up. Amen? So scripture proves, does it not, that Jesus, its prophecy fulfills it. There's others. There's the unity of the 66 books, how they all work together. Anybody ever read it all the way through? Well, do it sometimes. You'll be amazed at how it all fits. Even though it's not chronologically in order, it still all works together. And all these different writers, about 30 different writers who wrote the 66 books, and how that they share things, and what's in one scripture is in another scripture. You can prove virtually everything in the New Testament by the Old Testament because all the Word works together to prove Jesus Christ. Amen. You know what? They tried to eliminate it. Countries have made it illegal. They burnt all the Bibles in communists. The Soviet Union at one time, Red China. People have gone to jail because they had a one page out of the book of John. You know what you can't do? You can't destroy the number one best-selling book that's ever been in the whole world. There are more copies of God's Word in this world than there are many of the other books all put together. Because people know that it's true and it's about Jesus. And then, of course, we have all the accuracy. You know what amazes me is how that science tries to disprove the Bible. But the more that you study science, the more the Bible proves the science. And the science proves the Bible. I'm telling you, people don't know what happened to dinosaurs. The Bible tells you what happened to dinosaurs. Yeah. It'll tell you what happened. It'll tell you why they got them skulls this big around. And they dig them up and they hide them because they don't want people to know it. Ezekiel even tell you about UFOs if you know how to read it. All right, they fly around in the sky. It's all in here. This Bible proves scientifically everything that happened, including the Grand Canyon and a whole lot of other things. It makes me love the Bible more, amen? And then there's this here too. This Bible talks about the power of Jesus Christ to save souls, amen, to change lives. Did you ever read a book that changed your life like God's Word did? Never read a book, did you? Never had somebody share a few passages out of a book and it changed you forever and gave you peace and gave you hope and gave you joy because it has the power to save. Amen? It's amazing, really, when you look at the scriptural proof of Jesus in God's Word. And then, of course, there's this spiritual proof that goes with it. What else can quicken and make you come alive, can convict you and chastise you and comfort you and carry you through a day? Jesus through his Word. Yes. Amen. It's awesome, really. Why wouldn't I want to be accountable to someone who can do whatever that I need to do for me? Why would I not want to be accountable to him and listen to him and do what he says and allow him to control my life to some extent by offering me all the encouragement and advice that I need to tell me where I need to go, what I need to do, who I need to be with, who I don't need to be with, what I need to preach, what I need to wear, what I need to eat, how I need to take care of. He's got all the answers. Why would I not want to be accountable to Jesus? Amen. See, I can't do that for you, even though you are accountable to me. I'm second place. Jesus is first place. All right? If it's too hard for me, you know where to go? Go to Jesus. Be accountable to him. Let him give you these answers. Amen. And when Ruby was preaching on a Wednesday night over in 1 John. When you get over in chapter 5, I tell you, Holy Spirit will tell you that he is worthy to be accounted to. Jesus is worthy because he paid the price. He paid it all. That's one of the old songs in the hymnal. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Amen. Maybe you never heard that song. Maybe I'll look it up and sing it to you. Because it's true. All to him I owe. Where would we be today without Jesus? What kind of shape would we be in? I tell you where I'd be without Jesus. I'd been in a grave about 8 weeks ago. And there'd been a marker on it, a stone that said, "Here lies Pastor Dale Hartle from Word of Faith Family. He left loving you." Amen. That's where I'd have been without Jesus. I promise you. But you know what? Probably wouldn't have never got to then. Because back when we was dumb, young and dumb and crazy, we did a lot of things that God protected us from. Why would I not want to be accountable to Jesus? I can't think of any other reason. That's the personal witness right there. That's number four, the personal witness. All right, what he's done for me, what I've watched him do for others. It blessed me, Maisie sitting in front of me, and she bows down at an altar and her children are watching her, and she gets up with tears streaming down her face. And you know what? Amen. Look what the Lord has done, right? And I don't just watch Maisie, I watch all of you. Look what the Lord has done. How many of you have tasted, all right? Taste, you know, ain't that what the psalmist, he wrote? Try me, taste me, see that I'm good. You know what? I've seen that he's good. Yeah, I've tasted some things I didn't like. But I have never tasted anything that Jesus did for me, got for me, bought for me, gave to me that I did not love. Amen. He has proven himself over and over and over again. You know, when they were singing that song, and it talks about, Kelly was singing, going through the valley of the shadow of death. Amen. Going through the valley. I think about that helicopter ride. And all I could say was, I can't breathe. I take that mask off and tell him, I can't breathe. I can't breathe. I never experienced 1 minute of fear in that helicopter ride. I lay in that hospital bed praying, and I never experienced 1 minute of fear, not 1 minute. And I prayed all the time I was in there. I couldn't sleep, so I just prayed, talked with God. Not 1 minute of fear. I was never afraid. A peace that passes understanding. When they, yea, though I walked through the valley of the shadow of death, he was with me right there. I knew that he was. I'm telling you, it's an amazing thing to taste God, to prove God, to know that he's able to raise you up off a deathbed and to restore your health and send you back to work, all right? To family that you love, people that you love, church that you love, friends that you love. I'm telling you, God, if for no other reason that I would be accountable to him, I would do it for that one right there alone, for the personal witness. If I never owned a Bible and didn't know how to read and had no scripture and wasn't sure what that was that lived in my heart, whether or not it was the Holy Spirit or not, and if I didn't know all those things that we now know that's been proven to us out of the Word of God, I would know by my personal witness that Jesus Christ is worthy for me to be accountable to. Amen. I would know that. And I do. There's no other name given among men whereby we must be saved. And there is no other name given among men whereby we must become accountable to in this life if we want to serve Christ, be found faithful, and stand before him with a clean slate. You could do everything that I tell you to do, everything that I preach to you, and without you being accountable to Jesus himself, you might still not make it. People have sat on church pews for years and years and years of their life and listened to pastors and messages and paid tithes and done good deeds and died and went to hell because they never became accountable to Jesus Christ by never accepting him, never coming into covenant with him, and never really living for him, walking in obedience to him, and being accountable for what they did. Isn't that a terrible, terrible shame? Terrible shame. Wonderful people, loving people, moral people, good people, family people, some in my family, some in yours. Are you accountable today to Jesus? Can you overcome this accountability battle? Because it'll be a battle every day of your life for you to do what God wants you to do, for you to listen to Jesus Christ and be obedient to Him. Because He's going to put some stops in your life, and He's also going to put some goals. Stop and go. Amen. All right, let's stand. All right, children, listen up. As you approach each day your battles, don't let your hearts faint. Fear not, Mike. Do not tremble, neither be afraid. For the Lord our God is He that goes with us to fight for us against all of our enemies to keep us safe. And now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord makes His face to shine upon you and is gracious to you. The Lord lifts up His countenance upon you and gives you His peace. Hallelujah and amen.